Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The apostles gathered around Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. Then he said to them, "Come away to a deserted place with me and let us rest for a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. So they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and villages and arrived ahead of them. As Jesus went ashore, he saw a great multitude, and he had compassion for them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Then he began to teach them many things. My brothers and sisters, this is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So when I telling me the story, and I tried to cheer up and say, well, the poor tree. A poor tree, what about me? It wasn't funny. Yeah, the ambulance came and took the tree and put it on the stretcher. At the very heart of the Christian faith, at the very heart of the Christian experience, there is a person. For you see, Christianity is not primarily a philosophy, a good idea, a system of morality. Even though there are followers of Jesus who have tried to reduce the gospel and the event that took place in the first century concerning Christ into one of those two things, or many things, but obviously some people turn Christianity into a mere morality, or they'll turn it into a type of philosophical ideology. To do this is to reduce the reality that Christianity presents to humanity. It all comes down to the person of Jesus of Nazareth. Without Jesus, there would be no such thing as Christianity. Christianity stands or falls upon the person of Christ. That is why it's so utterly important for you to ultimately answer that question for yourself. A question that is addressed to you by the living, risen Christ. Who do you say that I am? Ultimately, it doesn't matter what I say or anyone else says. It's what you say. And so Jesus of Nazareth always becomes this reality that we have to make a decision about. And who is Jesus and who he is for you makes all the difference in the world. And it's interesting that in the first reading from the prophet Jeremiah, there is a messianic prophecy or oracle about the stem of Jesse, the root of David, from which they would arise one who will come into the world. And through the proclamation of that, we will know that he is our righteousness. The Lord is our righteousness. And so righteousness should not be equated with some kind of moral code, no matter how enlightened that ethic may be for us. But this is not our way to righteousness. If we want to know and be inspired and empowered to do the good, we need to know the good. And the ultimate good is a person. And immediately this suggests to us that the basic nature of the Christian experience is the experience of being in relationship. God ultimately in the Christian revelation is personal. More personal than any one of us. And so our faith in the person of Christ is a very personal affair. It challenges us at the very heart of our being. And so we're asked that question, just who he is. Not in some objective way, but who is he to you? What has Christ become for you personally? This is at the very heart of the spiritual life that we have received through the Christian gospel and the Christian message throughout the ages. Christ is the ultimate moral standard for us. He in his person is that ultimate standard. Not all the rules and regulations that we think of and we make a part of the life of the church. If we were to devote ourselves merely to following rules and regulations, keeping all of our obligations, we could do that, but we would miss Christ. We must turn to Christ because ultimately he is the one who is our righteousness. And it's by virtue of the fact that I am in relationship with the person of Christ that I am in relationship with the divine life, with God, that ultimate mystery that is shrouded in the clouds of darkness that we can never fully know because it's beyond all human comprehension and intellectual endeavor. We must experience God by having an encounter with God, and that encounter was made possible historically in the coming of Jesus of Nazareth. And this too adds to the mystery because Jesus is just as human as you are, or I am. He is fully human. That has always been the historic profession of the church, that Jesus is fully human. But this is a great paradox for us because at the same time, we also say that he's fully divine. And this is a paradox because we cannot fully comprehend or explain this mystery. We are left just to affirm by faith that he is fully human and therefore he shares and participates in the life of humanity. And at the same time, he is fully divine, so that Jesus fully shares and participates in that divine life which is the source of all reality. And so we affirm both of these things, but we can never fully reconcile them. It is beyond the human intellectual enterprise to be able to comprehend God, so God ultimately remains a mystery to us. But God is not a mystery far removed from us. God is that great mystery that's within our midst, hidden within the depths of our hearts. And each one of us has this direct contact with the divine life. And how do we find God? We find God by going into the within of our existence. It's in that secret chamber in the depths of your heart. It's in that secret place that your human spirit encounters the divine spirit, whom we identify as the Holy Spirit. And that presence mediates to us the presence of the risen Christ. So Jesus becomes everything for us. And ultimately, Christianity is a personality cult. And the personality cult that is centered around the person of Jesus of Nazareth. Paul, the apostle, in his letter, says that Jesus is our peace. He not only creates peace, but Jesus, in his very person, is our peace. He is our righteousness, and he is our peace, and he is our good shepherd. He is the Alpha, he is the Omega, he is the beginning, he is the end, he is the way, the truth, and the life. This is the kind of language that we use, which falls so far short of the reality, to emphasize the incomparable place that Christ ought to have within the Christian spiritual life. If we lose sight of that, then we corrupt and warp Christianity into something else. If we put the emphasis on the church as an organization, then we convert and make Christianity simply another human institution. And institutions become oppressive. They do not liberate. So our life with God is a direct experience between the individual soul, the individual spirit of a human person, with the divine person who is revealed to us in Jesus Christ. He truly is our good shepherd. He is always with you. There is never a moment or an experience in life that he is not present to you. Christ was present as the good shepherd with my wife when she destroyed that car and walked away with minor damage. However, if she was seriously injured and was paralyzed, it would not diminish the fact that Christ was with her. It's not only that she got out of the accident unscathed. The fact is, even if the worst had happened, she would not have been abandoned by him. That is his promise. And even if it would have taken her life, you don't mind me using you as an illustration. We are told that the good shepherd would be with her. Yea, though I walk through the valley, the dark valley, overshadowed by death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me, and with your rod and your staff you comfort me. You see, my brothers and sisters, For us who are Christians, it's always been about Jesus. It always has been. It's all about him. And so we focus our attention and we put our eyes upon Jesus of Nazareth, who is the author and finisher of our faith. So essentially, the Christian life is what we would call Christological. It's all about Jesus. He is, that is, his life and his person becomes the lens through which we read the scriptures. And you'll note something. It's shocking, but I'll say this. Nowhere in the Bible is the scriptures identified as the Word of God. Nowhere. The scriptures give witness to the Word of God. For the Word of God is a person. It is Christ. He is the Word that was in the beginning with God. He was in the beginning with God and was face to face with God, and he himself was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus is the Word of God. He said to the Pharisees when they were challenging him because Jesus didn't live up to their scriptural orthodoxy or to the traditions of their religious institution. Jesus said to them, "You search the scriptures, thinking that in those scriptures you will find eternal life, not realizing that the scriptures bear witness to me." I was having a conversation last Sunday afternoon with my good friend, our good friend, Father Frank Wade Anderson. And we were talking about this thing about the scriptures, and this place. It is something that is produced by the life of the community. You see, the church is called to bear witness. That's why the church exists. "You shall be my witnesses," Christ said to his apostles. "And you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and even to the farthest ends of the earth. You are to be my witnesses, but you can't do it on your own human strength. Therefore, you have to wait for the coming of the Holy Spirit that will empower you to give witness." And so the life of the church, its primary task is to give witness to the world concerning Christ. We point people to the way, which is Christ. We point people to the truth, which is Jesus. It's not my theology, it's not my morality, or my philosophical ideology. It is the person of Christ himself. He is the ultimate standard and the lens through which we look at the scriptures. You want to interpret the Bible? Always interpret the Bible through the what is called the hermeneutic, or through the lens of Christ. Because Christ says that from Moses through the prophets and the writings, they all bear witness of him. Scripture is a witness. Scripture is created by the community of the faithful, by the church. And in the ancient times, and for many centuries, the only time you could hear the words of Scripture was when you came to church, because you always heard it in the context of the liturgy. The liturgy is the deposit of faith that has been passed on to us by the apostles, and the Scriptures are best heard in the context of the worshiping community. For as we are worshiping the risen Christ, who for us is the divinity that caused all things to come into being, as we worship him and we enter into relationship with him, then we can hear rightly the scriptures that are being spoken to us, because they point us and bear witness to that which is the only word of God, and that is Jesus the Christ. And so, ultimately, the scriptures are liturgical texts that we use in the life, in the worship of the church. So the prayers of the liturgy, which are informed by scripture, also bear witness to the work of Christ in the world. And so we are to be a community centered upon the mystery of the hidden God manifest in the person of Jesus. We can know what God is like by looking at the life of Jesus. We can know how we can look at other people within the community or without the community by looking at the example of Jesus. Jesus condemned and judged no one. We look at Jesus and we see how he treated the other. And the many others that come into our life, we learn how to treat them by observing that highest of all divine manifestations, the person of Christ. He becomes the ultimate standard. And how was Jesus? What was he like? And what in his life shows forth and manifests to us the truth about God and the truth about ourselves? We see it in the gospel story today. It's a simple story. It's not filled with theological pronouncements. The disciples had just come back from their mission. Jesus sent them out two by two to spread the news of the coming of the kingdom to all the villages and towns of Galilee. They came back and they were so thrilled because they too were able to replicate the works of Jesus by healing the sick and delivering people from the power and oppression of the demonic. And they came back with their reports to Jesus. They were amazed. But they also knew and recognized that the power they had wasn't coming from themselves. It was coming, so to speak, by way of delegation from Christ. So they came back to the source, to the one who sent them back. And they came in the presence of Jesus, and Jesus says, "Well, you look tired now. Let us go to the other side." We've been ministering to the great multitudes, and the crowds were all, wherever Jesus was a great multitude of people. And so they went across the lake in a boat to get away, to go on retreat, to have some downtime. When they got to the other shore, they were greeted by the same crowd they left behind because they ran along the northern shoreline to the Sea of Galilee, and they were waiting for them to come back. And then what did Jesus do? "You know, I'm just so sick of the crowds, all the paparazzi, and all this is going on." He didn't complain. Rather, he looked upon the multitudes with compassion. With compassion. That's what God is like for you, my brother and sister. He's a God of compassion. He knows your pain. He feels your pain with you. That's what the word literally compassion means. To be passionate with, to feel what you feel. He felt compassion for the multitudes. He knew of their needs. And in Matthew's gospel, when the story is told, he reaches out and he heals them all. And then he begins to teach them. Somehow, his compassion gave him the strength to minister to these people, even when he was at the point of utter and complete human exhaustion. My brothers and sisters, if we embrace the way of Jesus, we're embracing the way of compassion. And the thing about compassion is that when we are compassionate, we receive the necessary strength and power of God to show that compassion to the world. In this way, we manifest the presence of the person of Christ to those around us by every kind work of charity that we do. Whatever time when we show thoughtfulness to another, whenever we help carry a burden or dry a tear from the eye of another who's in pain, when we do these things, we are manifesting the presence of Christ in the world, for he is our only hope. He is the one who calls us back into relationship with God. It is through his suffering and death and resurrection that he has overcome even the greatest of all nemesis. And that is the enemy, the final enemy called death itself. So let it be our prayer this morning, my brothers and sisters, that we would focus on Jesus as the unique revelation of God to us. And let us respond to that revelation by being like him. And that, my brothers and sisters, is the gospel of the Lord.
Amen.
Shall we stand now as we profess our faith?